Yeah, okay. I just want to talk to you about a particular feature of mindfulness, which I call dereification. There are other terms for it in the literature, which I'll mention. I'm not going to actually give you a full detailed account of what mindfulness is, and the reason for that I hope will be obvious. But if you'd like to have more of a discussion about the flavors or varieties of mindfulness, we can do that maybe later this morning or this afternoon. So, first of all, one of the main things about the way we talk about mindfulness these days, and one of the reasons we talk about it, is actually stress. And the way that it has entered into the popular culture is actually largely through mindfulness-based stress reduction. And John Kabat-Zinn, when working at the UMass Medical School in Worcester, was initially at the pain clinic. He really, this program that he developed along with Saki Santarelli was focused largely on stress management. Not pain reduction, but actually dealing with the stress around pain. Which, as it turns out, also reduces pain, or the perception of pain. And stress is a good way to think about sort of one of the mechanisms that we're going to talk about in mindfulness that may be common to all of the many different styles of mindfulness. And this is from a well-known piece, a review article that talks about stress. And one way of thinking about the psychological definition or the psychophysiological definition of stress or a stressor is that it's a stimulus that activates the so-called HPA axis and or the sympathetic nervous system to help an organism to adapt physiologically to deal with a threat. So it's actually good. Stress is in many ways a good thing. It doesn't mean it's bad to be stressed. As John was saying, if you're in the jungle and a tiger leaps out at you, you want to be stressed unless you want to be dead. And then you can sort of more broadly say that this stress is also a feature in a broader sense when basically the demands on you somehow exceed your capacities or your resources. That's a larger picture of stress. But a lot of stress, you could say, has to do with threat, right? And my colleague Larry Barcelo has been doing some work on this and the relationship between threat, especially stress and threat to self. And it could even be, and possibly if we were to try to come up with a Buddhist understanding of stress, and there have been in previous mind and life dialogues more than one time when we've had 20-minute conversations to try to figure out how to translate stress into Tibetan and never succeeded. But that if we were to try to come up with a Buddhist account of stress, it would be really about threat to self. That a lot of what we experience as stress has to do with threat to self, direct or indirect. And when you have that type of a threat, in order to deal with the threat, what comes online, so to speak, is this fight or flight set of paradigms, if you like. And the organism gets ready to either fight or to run. Right? And not feed or breed, so to speak. You're looking to maximize resources, in other words, for your immediate survival. And resources that are important for your longer-term survival are going to be put on hold because, obviously, things like digestion really don't matter if you're dead. Nor does general maintenance, you know, cleaning out the cells, sleep, therefore, also. Reproduction, immune system, all of those types of functions are going to be put on hold. Some aspects of the immune system actually are ramped up in ways that are important. We'll talk about it in a moment. But immediate wound healing is not going to be a priority. You're going to be dealing with you're going to instead being prepared to be wounded, which means that the inflammatory aspect of your immune system is going to be ramped up. So I got this stuff from my colleague Chuck Rayzone, formerly at Emory and now at University of Arizona. This is a well-known review article that he recommended from Nature Reviews Immunology in 2005. And it's got, again, a nice summary. Stressors can increase susceptibility to infectious agents, influence the severity of infectious disease, diminish the strength of immune responses to vaccines, reactivate latent herpes viruses, and slow wound healing. Not so great. And basically, it accounts for all kinds of health risks. It may account for all kinds of health risks, or at least exacerbate health risks that are stress-related, such as cardiovascular disease, inflammatory bowel disease, and also psychological disorders like major depressive disorder. These may all be closely related to the physiology of stress. Okay? So, stress can occur in all kinds of situations. I probably don't need to tell you the details of this particular article, hostile marital interactions. We can all guess what that does to pro-inflammatory cytokines and wound healing. Let's just say these are not wounds inflicted during the interactions. Now, stress, the mind plays a very important role in stress. And it plays an important role at the level of what's called appraisal. When is this stimulus a threat? So we're talking about sort of attention. You're starting to load something. You're starting to pay attention to something. You're devoting more and more resources to that and inhibiting your attention to other things. You're starting to load it into certain categories, right? And to elaborate on those categories, to use the terminology in contemporary science. All of that is really as one way in which you're going to pay attention in this fashion. And in other words, one way in which that stimulus is salient is that it's being interpreted in terms of categories that are all threat, right? That's this activity of appraisal of a situation. That, importantly, that threat, that appraisal of those categories are not necessarily linked to the reality of the object in question. That's very important. There's an important role that your affective frame or your mood can play, and even your affective style. There's also connected to that the kinds of cognitive scripts or cognitive habits that you have, the different little narratives that we constantly play to ourselves. And, whoops, I'm sorry. And then the tendency toward reactivity and mental time travel are two other very important features in the development of stress. And I'm not going to talk about all of these, but I do want to talk about reactivity and then mental time travel, because this is going to help us understand a certain feature of mindfulness that cuts across many mindfulness styles and accounts perhaps for a lot of its efficacy in dealing with stress. So when we talk about reactivity, one way of thinking about reactivity is that it's driven by the affective frame that you're in, the kind of, you know, what type of mood you could say you are carrying with you, what your expectations are, along with the habitual stories or scripts that you have. And these will predispose you to react in a certain way to certain types of stimuli as a threat. Right? So this, in a sense, is your tendency. For example, some people become hypervigilant under certain conditions, with PTSD, for example, and that tendency to always be on, ready for a threat is a combination of factors that lead to this reactivity of perceiving threats very easily, a combination of factors that have to do with your affective habits and your cognitive habits. And actually your perception of self as well. And over time, this kind of reactivity can really be disastrous. We already went through some of the physiology, the way in which it can lead to many problems. Why I love this particular quote, this was from Robert Sapolsky in a 2009 meeting with His Holiness Dalai Lama. And he says, more than anything else, humans have invented adventitious suffering, the ability to feel pain and suffering for what once was, what will be, what could be, or what someone else experiences. In other words, now what we're dealing with are not sensory-driven stimuli. But they are, in an interesting way, they're sort of exogenous because of our cognitive habits and affective habits, we start to ruminate about this stuff helplessly, right? We start to think about the difficult conversation we had yesterday or the test we're going to take tomorrow or whatever it might be. And the central concept in the study of stress is this. If you are a zebra and a lion leaps out and rips your flesh open and you are in pain, running for your life, the things your body does then are wonderful, preparing you for example, all the inflammation that hosts it. stop that bleeding is very important. They're exactly what you need in order to survive. But if you are a human suffering from adventitious pain that results from ruminating about difficult situations, for example, your body does exactly the same thing. It floods your system with pro-inflammatory cytokines, for example. And if it does that for a long time, disease will arise. For example, cardiovascular disease. Right, and this is the great term here in Buddhism that I really love is the second arrow, which you will hear in some certain mindfulness context. This is from the Salata Sutta, Sutta in the Pali Canon. The Blessed One said, when touch or the feeling of pain, the uninstructed, run-of-the-mill person sorrows, grieves, and laments, beats his breast, becomes distraught. So he feels two pains, physical and mental, just as if they were to shoot a man with an arrow, and right afterward were to shoot him with another one. Right, so that he would feel the pain of two arrows. So this is this second arrow, which is that you have some kind of a context, right, where a memory arises. Not even necessarily dealing with sensory stimulation, although we might be dealing with some kind of a sensory trigger. But a memory arises, and we start to ruminate. We start to think about a difficult situation. We start to reenact our own suffering. And actually that reenactment of our past suffering or anticipation of some future suffering produces the stress reaction in the body in a way that is similar to the actual event. And this is called mental time travel. And there's a sort of literature in psychology about this, but basically what it means is that we have the capacity to do kind of full body simulations that actually bring online in the brain representations of the body in the motor cortex and so on when you are running these types of what are called episodic memories. And these full body simulations sometimes happen they seem to be involuntary in some cases. We simply get caught in a traumatic memory. We relive the trauma quite literally in an embodied fashion. Even though you're not moving, your parts of your brain that are involved in motion are actually active, and you re-traumatize yourself physiologically and not just mentally. Right? So that is a main feature, way in which we can create psychosocial stress for ourselves, either by reliving past events or anticipating future events. And since these kinds of simulations are fully embodied, they induce the physiological responses that we mentioned before, and when those simulations are about threats, obviously we're going to get a stress response. So, how did all this work? This is one of my favorite examples, is always the strawberries. So this is a good time for this, because it's almost lunchtime. If you look at the strawberries, and you, those of you that like strawberries like me, whose mouth is watering already? Just by looking at that picture. So this is the effect we're talking about. This is a stimulus-driven one, but you can just do this mentally too. Like if I say, I don't know, maybe you like a nice organic sandwich. It's like, right? Your body reacts. Right? Now that's an amazing thing. The human cortex can do that sort of thing. It's really quite remarkable. But, and in many ways it's good, but sometimes it's really maladaptive. So how do we deal with that? Well, one way we deal with that is mindfulness. But I want to point out that I won't read through all of this quote. Basically, this is a quote from Alan Wallace, who I admire greatly. But on this particular point, I really disagree with him, which is that there's this idea that there's going to be a single authoritative version of mindfulness that we have to adhere to. I think that's a very problematic idea. If we ask what is mindfulness really, who's right about mindfulness, the answer is that nobody is right. Or if you like, everybody is right. In what sense, it's a term within both Buddhism and contemporary context that applies to a range of practices, all of which can be traced to authoritative Buddhist sources. So if anyone tells you this is the true mindfulness, they're not telling you the whole story. And the best place to understand mindfulness, I think, is to look at the actual practices that are present, especially right now, that we can examine. And some colleagues and I have employed a phenomenological, or developing a phenomenological model that's going to be tied to neurophysiology, or that is tied to a review of neurophysiological studies. And those colleagues are Cliff Saren, Amishi Jha, and Antoine Lutz. And this is the early version of the model, but I'm not allowed to describe it to you yet. I just wanted to show you the the cool picture. They said I can't tell you yet. It's hopefully going to be out soon, maybe in American Psychologist. But what you will see here is that one of the dimensions, this is a plot of a phenomenological space that allows us to plot different styles of mindfulness and different trajectories in the development of mindfulness in this phenomenological space, and then develop hypotheses about the neurophysiology that might underlie some of these different styles and states of mindfulness. But one of the dimensions you see here is reification. And that's one that seems to be very important across all styles of mindfulness. Reification. And reification in general has to do with, is a particular feature of the distortion, it's one of the three kinds of distortion that occur in all thought, according to Buddhist theory. All thought is in a certain way distorted. What you can say in a way is that, to go back to what John was saying, thought is, as we go higher and higher in our categorization process, and as we're paying more and more attention to something, we are ignoring features of the object that are irrelevant to what we need, because we don't want to devote resources to that, right? That's a psychological way of discussing that. In the Buddhist context, that means that we are becoming less and less well-informed about the object. We're actually locking it into categories that are good for certain purposes, but actually obscure parts of the object. We're forgetting, in a sense, parts of the object. So there are three features of thought that do this are, first of all, we already talked about this, is time travel. Thought is always, when you're locking something into a category, in the Buddhist theory and in some theories embodied cognition, categorization is always about previous experience. So you're always to a certain degree you are connecting to previous, you're bringing previous experience into the present, right? So that's one way in which it's distorting. The other is this flattening, which we just described, which is basically that you ignore features of the object that are irrelevant to the context, and you actually heighten some other features. And part of the way you ignore this is that you flatten out distinctions among individuals. For example, all blue-eyed people are like X, right? All blonde people are this way, right? All Republicans are wonderful. And what? And so on and so forth. Right? And then the third one is reification, which these two, right, are important, but this is the one that's the one that really drives stress response. Because reification is that the representation you have, the mental representation of that object, especially if we're dealing with not a stimulus-driven object, but one that's just a spontaneous memory, for example, that kind of spontaneous episodic memory presents itself as real. If I daydream about myself on the beach, which is similar to episodic memory, and I'm really caught up in that daydream, I start to have kind of embodied experience of being on the beach. That daydream doesn't, when I come out of that daydream, part of the reason I come out of that daydream is I recognize that the simulation is not real. That's when I stop daydreaming. I realize, oh, I'm not on the beach, I'm in a bus, right? So that moment of recognizing that the simulation is unreal is a moment in which a simulation presenting itself as what's happening to you suddenly is derealized or dereified, right? And that is a very key feature of mindfulness, this process of dereification. So how does mindfulness operate in this way? Well, to deal with time travel, it emphasizes awareness in the moment. To deal with flattening, it emphasizes attention to detail, especially sensory detail. But then especially to eliminate reification, you cultivate this feature that seems to be perhaps why mindfulness is so effective in certain contexts for dealing with stress, which is dereification, also known as decentering, defusion, cognitive insight, mindful awareness, and so on. There are many different terms for it in the literature right now. And it is simply that capacity to experience a thought not as what it represents, but rather not as what, but I've done this, shown this slide here before, I think, once. Not as what it represents, but as simply a thought. And I love this picture, some of you know it, of Marguerite, because it is a visual representation of this idea. So if I say to you, what is this? What is it? What? It's a pipe? It's not a pipe. It's actually, of course, Marguerite's thing is, ceci n'est pas une pipe. This is not a pipe. It's a picture of a pipe. Right? That's the point. It's what is, and this idea of experiencing your thought as just a thought and not what it seems to represent has actually been experimentally examined in a very nice study. I think this is the only one that really directs this, addresses this directly, by Esther Papier's, Larry Barsler, and Ruud Koster's. And Esther is in the Netherlands. Basically, they took pictures of food. And without going into great detail in the study, you had to press a button that made the picture come toward you if it had a green frame around it, and another button that made it go away from you if it had a red frame around it. And when there was a conflict, i.e. it was delicious food, like a nice piece of chocolate cake, and it had a red frame, you're just like, I don't want to make it go away. So your reaction time was slower. And then they gave a very simple instruction. That was all part of the study. They gave a very simple instruction, which was just see the picture as a picture. And the reaction time difference disappeared. Right? So that is learning this kind of dereification. Now the claim is, of course, we have that as a natural capacity, because if we didn't, we'd be stuck in our daydreams forever. And so we have this natural capacity to sort of drop a simulation. That's something innate. And you can train that capacity, just like you can train attention. So what that means, very simply, is now, just before lunch, when we look at this picture, if we just say, it's just a picture, it's not strawberries, we correct our categorization, so to speak, we just experience it as colors and light, then we are no longer salivating. Unless you really like strawberries and you can't help yourself. But so that's dereification. I think it's possibly the most important mechanism within mindfulness from a therapeutic standpoint. Thanks very much.